blessings to everybody this morning. Those who are watching virtually, we thank God for each and every one of you this morning. It is blessed. God has allowed us one more opportunity to come together as a body and to fellowship. Amen. And also that I got some news that I want to share with you. Amen. Yesterday, I was at a homegoing service, amen. And the invitation was extended, and I had a piece that came to give her life to Christ. And she wants to do something.
Oh, the labor. Save me, I want to come down. Psalm 27, verses 1 through 8. A Psalm of David. Psalm 27, verses 1 through 8. The Lord is my life and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came on me to eat up my flesh, they stung and fell. Though a host should encamp around me, my heart should not fear. Thy war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up on the rock. And now shall my head be lifted above my enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifice of joy. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also on me and answer me. When you said, seek ye my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, I will see. May the Lord have blessed you to the reading of his holy word for the edification of our soul.
Oh,
Praise God.
show up in you.
Thank you.
our Father.
Thank you.
Your Son, Jesus Christ. Our Lord and Savior. The Holy Spirit. Who is our comfort? Who is our keeper? Our leader and our captain. One who empowers us to live a holy life. We thank God for Elder Moore and Elder Buford this morning. First and foremost, He is our example to the believer in Christ. He is our example. not only is he, he's our perfect example, meaning that he is the standard that we all look to. I think oftentimes we look at others and compare ourselves to them when they themselves fall short.
All right.
Our eyes need to be on someone who is perfect. And as I look in this sanctuary and I look at myself in the mirror, there is no perfection there. But I will say that we should be moving towards perfection. Do I have any witnesses in this room? Yeah, our eyes should be on him. I come to understand that Jesus did not do anything on his own, or of his own. And not only that, he did those things that would glorify his Father. In John 5 and 19, he said, "Most assuredly I say to you, the Son of God, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do, the Son also does in like manner." And if he is our example, we should be looking at him. Perhaps somebody may say, well, preacher, I can't physically see Jesus, but I tell you where you can find him spiritually. You can read through the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and they'll tell you about the life of Jesus Christ. And then after you read that, and you ought to follow him. Amen. We ought to follow him. So there's no excuse for the believer, but somebody that's living in the world, they don't know Jesus. Just like at one time you and I did not know Jesus, but God put something in us to let us know when we were doing wrong. Yeah, you know when you do wrong, when you're doing wrong. You might act like you don't know. I'll just say, if you have to sneak and do something, you know it's wrong.
All right.
Am I right about it? If you got to sneak and do it, are you trying to creep around in the nighttime hoping that nobody sees? But I come to tell you, somebody sees you.
Right.
Most importantly, God sees you.
Right.
You can hide all you want. You can come out in the midnight. God, the midnight is like light to God. I penetrate through darkness.
Yeah.
You thought Superman could see through faith. But I tell you, God can see right through you. If your worship is real, he can see it. If it's fake, he can see it.
All right.
Not only that, we are called to glorify God. Very well known scripture, Matthew 5 and 16. It says, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." So you and I have work to do.
Yes, sir.
Right, yeah.
Not that we go around and flung our good works, boasting on our good. Not I'm boasting in the Lord. Paul said that he's boasting in the Lord. He's not boasting in himself, because he himself had problems. If you read chapter 7 of Romans, Paul had some problems too.
All right.
And he recognized he had some problems. You and I, we recognize we have problems, we have faults. And even if you don't want to admit it this morning, I got to tell you, you're not perfect this morning.
Amen.
And we find Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20, I believe, and the first part of that verse, he says, "Now then, we are ambassadors of Christ." In other words, if you are that ambassador, you're representing someone.
Right.
You say that you are a child of God, that you are following Jesus Christ, you ought to be a representative. You ought to live like you have a relationship with the Lord Jesus. No, you can't just live any kind of way. Somebody said that. It's repetitive. I'm glad that the word of God is repetitive. Because if you can read something in Colossians, you can go to Ephesians, and it's written about the same thing. And even with Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they tell the life of Jesus repetitively. We need to hear the word repetitively. Because sometimes
we get hard-headed, like we call our children, hard-headed children. We sometimes are hard-headed people ourselves. Is anybody in agreement with me this morning? Are you sometimes hard-headed? Do you always do what God asks you to do, though? Yeah, God said you to go this way, but you want to go that way.
All right.
We can ask Brother Jonah about that.
All right.
God was calling him to go one way. He wanted to go in another direction. And only find himself in some trouble. Have you ever been there?
Yes,
God told you to go this way, but you decided to go that way and find yourself in a mess. A mess that you got yourself into, and a mess that you couldn't get yourself out of. If you begin to cry, ask Jonah, when he found himself in a bad situation, he began to call on God. Have you ever been there? So the question this morning is, are you identifying with the world, or are you identifying with Jesus? It's your choice.
All right.
I mean, I was saying, if you living the way the world is living, or are you living like Christ is living? I'm not saying that we can heal those that are sick. I'm not saying that we can raise the dead back to life. I'm not saying that we have the power to save anybody. But I tell you, we live like we know a God that can do all things but fail. No, I don't have the power to heal you of your sickness. Yes, sir, they might claim they do, but I declare this morning they don't have the power. Only God has the power to heal sickness. The doctor prescribes you medicine, but it's not the medicine that heals you. If God don't touch the medicine, you won't be healed. And I'm saying God uses the medicine to help heal you, but ultimate healing only comes from God.
Amen.
That's where Romans 1 and 2 comes in. He said, Apostle Paul said, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. In other words, we have to give ourselves to him.
Amen.
He's not going to force himself on you. He's not going to force you to live in a certain way. You have to make up in your own mind that I declare before heaven and earth, I will live for the Lord.
Amen.
He goes on to verse 2. Verse 2, he said, and do not be conformed to this world. But be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Yes, sir.
I can't live like I want to live. I think that I'm doing a good service.
All right.
Now he calls us to live a life that we're so radiant that it shines out to those that don't know him, and even to those of us who are saved, that all of us are struggling somewhere.
Amen.
You have to own up to struggling somewhere. But our conduct ought not be like it used to be, where he brought us from and brought us out of. That was Paul that was reminding the church at Colossus that they used to be this way. You know what I'm talking about. You used to be certain type of way. You used to act in some certain type of way. Come on, talk with me this morning.
Come on.
You weren't always. You didn't always hear words that would glorify God. Come on, talk with me this morning. Because I know myself, I used to love the church. I was bad when it came to church.
All that coffee wasn't glorifying God.
You know how it is. Most of us, we were coming up there with some trends, and we tried to follow the trend, didn't we? Come on, be honest with you. You tried to do what everybody else is doing. Don't you understand that somebody goes out stealing, you in the car with them, or you with them, whatever, and you ain't even doing it, but you're with them. So in other words, you're associated with them. So when they get caught, you get caught.
Yes,
right. You didn't have nothing to do with it. That's why you got to be careful. I'm talking about young folks. Be careful who you hang with. Be careful who you call your friend, because everybody ain't your friend. Everybody ain't out for your best. Some people are jealous of you just because you trying to live a holy life. You know good and well if they were jealous of Jesus. And we don't even get to match Jesus. One who was perfect, one who did not sin at all. But loved God. But then he says that, you know, set your mind on things above, not on the things on this earth. For you die in your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. When Jesus died, when the Father raised him, we were put in a place. We're put in a place of right relationship through Jesus when we receive him as our Lord and Savior. And we do understand that he is coming back. It says he, right here in verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Meaning that I have an eternal. I have a glorified body, a new body, a body that will harbor no more pain, no more aches, no more sickness, no more disease. Is anybody glad to hear that this morning? All he's saying is that you're a new creation now. Second Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he or she, I put it like that, he or she is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new.
Yes, sir.
Can anybody identify with that?
It wasn't me that made the change. It was Lord Jesus Christ that made the change in me. I have a regenerated heart. He changed the way I think. He changed the way I do. He changed the way I talk. Uh-oh, look, sometimes some words slip out. I'm just being honest. I'm just being honest. Sometimes some words slip out. Some thoughts come to your mind.
Yeah.
And sometimes you act out on those thoughts.
Yeah.
Don't talk with me.
Yeah.
No need to be ashamed. Because, as I said, none of us are perfect. All of us are made mistakes. But ain't God good?
Yeah.
How many of y'all know he good this morning?
Yeah.
Girlfriend,
all right.
Not just somebody I meet.
All right. I got ahead, Pastor.
See, I got to stand before God. I got to keep it real, whether you want to hear it or not.
That's right.
I got to tell it like it is. The best I know how. How he gave it to me, how he helped me with it. Fornication. All not be named among the children of God. He goes on to say uncleanliness, impurity of thoughts. Our thoughts ought to be pure.
Yeah.
He said, your thoughts can be impure in word or action. In other words, moral filth. Then he goes on to say passion, strong and unbridled lust. The Bible said if you lust, it's just like you had already done it. That's sin. He said, evil desire. It says, intense and altered violent craving. Covetousness, greediness, or the desire to have more. It may refer especially to unholy desire to satisfy sexual appetite, which is idolatry. And the reason why it's idolatry, because you're not following the true and living God. You're doing everything that God is asking us and commanding us not to do. When you find yourself living like this, it says that the wrath of God will come upon you. It says right there in verse 6, because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, in which you yourself once walked when you lived in them. See, he's just reminding them of where they were, what God had brought them out of, and he's reminding us today where we were. And they're being careful. We'll find ourselves doing those things again. And then I want to touch the point again about he did not call men to be with men, and women to be with women. When you have spare time, go and read Romans chapter 1. It says that he'll give you up to a reprobate mind as you continue in those things.
All right now.
Yeah, they used to take part in these things. They used to practice these things. You and I practice something. It might not be with man and man and woman and woman, but you was grooving with somebody that was not your spouse. I know that ain't what everybody wants to hear, but it's the word of God. It's the truth. It's the truth.
That's right.
You can stand on the truth. It's the word of God that delivers. Somebody here might have something they need to be delivered from. All of us have something we need to be delivered from. If I could deliver myself, I would stop doing it. If you could deliver yourself, you would stop doing it. But I tell you, God is able to deliver you. None of us can call ourselves a child of God if we don't want to hear to his word.
All right.
I can't go around hating people.
Right.
I can't go around talking down on people.
All right.
Because before I came to Christ, there were some things about me that was not right. Anybody that walked through these doors has some trouble in their life. They have some problems. Some of them are coming because they feel this is the place to come.
Yes, sir.
But we're not living or conducting our lives as Christ.
Uh-huh.
That's no help to them. We're not even helping ourselves.
All right.
We're not even helping one another.
All right.
When we find a brother, sister, and father, we ought to go to them in love. Not talking down on them.
Right.
If you go talking down to somebody, they ain't listening to nothing you got to say.
Amen.
But if you come with a heart, love, fight, and they'll be willing to listen to you.
Amen.
all we're doing is planting seeds. Are you planting good seeds or are you planting bad?
All right.
You can talk it all day.
Uh-huh.
But if you not living,
yeah.
Okay. you ain't doing nothing.
Right.
That's not, you ain't doing nothing. But if you talk it and plus living, you doing something. First of all, I'm bringing glory to God.
Uh-huh.
Second of all, I'm living like Christ.
Uh-huh.
As close as I can.
Uh-huh.
He goes on in verse 8, he says, but now you yourselves are to put off all these, some more things he has to say, some more characteristics here. It says anger. And the commentator said, hey, a strong spirit of dislike, or animosity, a vengeful spirit, a subtle spirit of hatred. Now, no Christian has the audacity to have a strong spirit of dislike, or animosity, a vengeful spirit. I would not be trying to get back to somebody because they groan. That's when the groan suffering comes in. He talks about that. The person has been chained. He said, that's long suffering.
When God don't suffer for us,
then he don't suffer for us today.
All right.
Then he says that. That's another word. Wrath.
Uh-huh.
An intense form of anger. Probably involving outbursts. Say something you ain't got no business saying, because somebody did something you didn't like. And you may call them a word. And you know if they're a child of God or not. Even if they're not a child of God, you should respond in that way. Can I be honest this morning? I've done it.
All right.
The Lord forgive me.
Yeah.
In the heat of the moment.
Yeah.
We don't respond like we should. Then he says another word there, malice. He says wicked conduct toward another person with the idea of harming a person or the reputation of a person. It is an unreasonable dislike that takes pleasure in seeing others suffer. She deserved what she got. You know she done this, you know she done that. You know he was involved with this and involved with that. They get what they deserve. What if God give you and I what we deserve? We wouldn't be here this morning. But yet we quickly call out everybody else's fault.
Any.
our presence today. He wouldn't bring up your past. He wouldn't talk about you. He'd embrace you. He'd love on you. And that's what the world needs. It's the love of God. And we as Christians, we ought to be expressing that love.
That's right.
And he talks about the filthy language, as I said, that sometimes that the words we speak are shameful. Our words does not represent the Christ that we serve. So we have to be careful of the words we speak. That we speak towards others. We have to be careful. Because I come to tell you, God hears. God sees. God knows your thoughts. You wouldn't even empty your mind. You cannot hide anything from all knowing God. Yeah, God knows every one of our thoughts right now, all together. Ain't that a powerful God? Who would want to serve a God like that? Would we rather serve those gods that can't do us anything? Can't do no good for us? Can't get us out of no trouble? Can't heal us? Can't change our life? The God, the Creator, we can do all that and then something. And he says in verses 12 through 14, he begins to throw some characteristics of those who have put on a new name. And if you're not practicing these things, it's not too late. You're still breathing. Blood's still running warm in your vein. And if you're not practicing them, why not? You can't claim to be something that you're not living. Come on, is there anybody? I can't claim to be something that I'm not. He says in verse 12, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies. What is tender mercies? A heart of compassion. Did not Jesus have compassion? There was instances Jesus seen people and he had compassion on them. Do you see people have compassion on them? He says that kindness speak of the unselfish spirit of doing for others. It is an attitude of affection, of goodwill. All right. You ought to be kind. I ought to be kind. If we say we're the children of God and my focus is on Christ, you ought to see some kindness in each one of us. He says humility means lowliness, the willingness to be humble and to esteem others better than oneself. Now that's a lot of time. We don't want to humble ourselves. We don't want to esteem others better than ourselves.
All right.
Oh, no, they don't wait that
long. All right.
No, they don't deserve me being nice to them. And if I seen them, they getting over on me. Especially if they've done this wrong, they getting over on me. Right. But see, that lets me know my focus is not right.
All right.
My focus is not right.
All right.
Then he says, meekness, the strength to deny oneself, as a walking in grace toward all men, even unsaved. Because the Bible said, be a light. They sung the song, show up.
Yeah.
Show up. Right. You show up if you're real. You show up. You show up.
Yeah.
And that long suffering, I told you, God is long suffering with us today.
Right.
If I can't forgive those who wrong, I'm not living a Christ-like life.
All right.
God forgave you and he forgave me. Anybody can receive this forgiveness. But you got to know it's something. Not only knowing, but you have to have it in your life. And he goes on and says, bearing with one another. Patience. Again, long suffering. We should have with the failings and odd ways of our brethren. In living with others, it is inevitable that we will find out their failings. I believe all of us have some failings.
That's right.
It often takes the grace of God for us to put up with the temperament of others as it must for them to put up with ours. But we must bear with one another. You got some people that irritate you. Am I right about it? You got some people that bother you. And I'm quite sure you irritate some people, you bother some people. But Christ said, we ought to deal with one another. In other words, we ought to deal with one another in love. Quit looking at each other's fault. If I find out something about you, I ought to be praying for you and praying for myself. But mostly, what do we do when we find out somebody's problem?
You said it right.
We talk about it. Yes, that ain't Christ-like. It should not be any of us in this sanctuary this morning looking at one another in a bad way.
Right.
Talking about one another.
Right.
We are a body. And if we forgot Christ is the head, if we look to the head, we'll get it right. We'll be walking in the right direction. As soon as we take our eyes off here, we begin to get out of line. He says, forgiving one another. Anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. Verse 14, but above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. He called us to be at peace with one another. He didn't call us to be against one another. He didn't call us to be in chaos, but in peace, in love, and in joy with one another. Somebody said, I just can't do it. I can't find myself doing it. Well, if you yield to the Spirit of God, you'll find that you can do it. It might not happen today, but if you continue to seek Him, continue to pray and talk to God, eventually the change will come. Just like when you were lost, you begin to cry out, God saved your soul. But he says, in verse 17, whatever you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. And the reason we do it in the name of Jesus, because He has done so much for you and me. We can read about the life of Jesus. How those who were blind, He gave them sight. Those who were sick, He healed their bodies. You and I were so far from the Father that He became our mediator between God and man. He's done so much for us. He's done so much for us, I tell you.
Yes, yes.
This morning, He stopped by. And He woke you up. He's provided for you every single day of your life. Yeah, we was in a mess. He was right there to rescue us. I was way offshore.
Straight way up.
Get it right in, but the way off. Then see the sin. But look at Jesus. He stopped by and guided you right back where you need to be. Yeah, do it all in the name of Jesus. Love people in the name of Jesus. Treat folks right in the name of Jesus. To folks in the name of Jesus. You can do it in the name of whoever, but I come to tell you, you ought to do it in the name of Jesus, because if you do it in the name of Jesus, he's signing off and stamping his name. Yes.
Yes, Lord.
We do it in his name.
Yeah.
Because he took your sin.
Yeah.
I seen the whole world sin.
Yeah.
He became sin for us.
Yeah.
I couldn't pay my way out of this. I couldn't buy my way. I couldn't live good enough to get out of what I was in. I'm so glad that God's Son came.
Yeah.
And that your sins and my sins are on himself.
Yeah.
And he hung down on Calvary's cross.
Yes, sir.
He hung there.
Yeah.
You and I.
Yeah.
It said that he gave up the ghost and he died.
Yeah.
He died.
Yeah.
It said they put him in a bar or two.
Yeah,
yeah, they placed him in a bar or two.
Uh-huh.
I'm so glad that the tomb was just barred.
Yeah.
He didn't need it.
Yeah.
He just only barred it for 3 days. I'm so glad on that third and fourth morning that Jesus got up with all power in heaven and earth. Don't be trying to get ready. Be ready. he'll come as a thief in the night. Don't wait too late. Today could be your day. Today is the day of salvation. You may leave this sanctuary today.
Thank you.
baptism on next Sunday. Amen.
Amen.
Be baptized on next Sunday. Amen.
Amen.
And I thank God for that.
Amen.
I thank God for that. God has a way of touching all. He desires to change all of us. So don't stop praying. You may be feeling the same. Just keep on praying. Keep on talking to God. God will answer. Good answer. Amen. Is there anything else to be
wrong?
Amen. All right. God's satisfied. Oh.
I just want to thank God for this day, and I thank Pastor Moore and the pulpit, Elder Moore, and the other pastor, preacher there. And I know Pastor was saying last week that he thought we was leaving last Sunday, but I just want to say this is not a goodbye. Lord willing, this is we'll see y'all later, one way or another. And I'm just satisfied, like my aunt Nell said. I'm satisfied today. It was a blessed service. The choir showed out. Man, it just felt real good, you know, because to come in with all kind of emotions, because I've been with St. Andrew for so long. And so, but this service just uplifted me, young brother coming back, and so it feels like a little circle going around there. So, but I want to thank the choir, all the leaders of the church, the deacons. Thank you. I love y'all. The mothers, the deaconess, the usher board, and the trustees, and the choir members, the kids, everyone that it takes to make up St. Andrew, and all that you're putting in your time and effort in the church, because it does take a whole community, a body to run a church. So I thank everyone for their service to the church. And I'd encourage you, if someone's not doing anything in the church and maybe want to get involved and use your talents for the church, for the building of the kingdom of God, hey, just figure out what it is that you're good at and what you want to do in the church. Because the church needs it, you know. But I'm satisfied for today, and I just want to tell everybody thank you, and we love y'all. We still got work that we have to do ourselves, so it's not going to be we're leaving the church, but wherever we are, we still got work to do for God's kingdom, so we're still going to be putting in the work over there.
Amen. To see you. Amen. Amen. All hearts and minds are satisfied. And I'm always excited to see that end.
St. Andrew PB Church, where Elder Buford Moore III is pastor, is located at 1393 Swancott Road, Madison, Alabama, 35756.